The Charleston basketball tradition to me means winning, dedication, love for the game, competitiveness, high expectations.
When you say something about Charleston basketball, you think about winning, great players, good coaches, you know, good fans.
You had to prepare for Charleston every game that you played them. They wasn't a team that you could just go out and play, because if you did, you got your butt beat, you know.
The pride in the community came, you know, with people everywhere. Anywhere you went, you were from Charleston. Oh, you one of the Charleston Blue Jays. Yes. People recognized the community then, and it made everybody feel much better about who they were. I graduated from Bethel College in McKinsey, Tennessee in 1969. In the fall of the year, I was hired as math and English teacher for the Charleston R1 School District. The school was integrated, not desegregated. And when I say integrated, they had put everybody into the same school system, but they were still separate. The black students, they sat with black students. White students sat with white students. They very seldom mingled. It was still kind of hateful on both sides. But the very first year, that was a situation where the students, the black students actually walked out. And then they had several meetings at Curran's Cafe and at the churches. And then a couple of years later, with the firing of the black assistant principal, that's when I remember a big walkout started. And as far as I know, there's not been an African-American administrator at the high school since then.
The one thing I remember when I was a freshman was they got rid of the assistant principal, and there was a big sit-in and stuff like that. But after that, I mean, there was never any issues, at least in my mind, black-white. Everybody got along.
If you leave young people alone, they will work it out for themselves. Before that, parents were telling you what to do. Don't have anything to do with these people. Don't sit next to them. Don't go out with them. But it eventually, the young people worked it out for themselves. And some of them became best friends.
As you know, this has always been a football town. Basketball has always been the second banana, or it was in that period.
Football was the tradition around here. Charlie Babb had graduated from here, and they were still believing that there were other pro football players in the area just waiting to be discovered.
I mean, everybody wanted to play basketball all the time, but I guess the feeling that we were going to win was never there.
You know, Charleston always had a great bunch of talent over there, and they just never was organized and put together. When Lucian was there, we went over and played Charleston over in the Oran tournament and beat them. Well, about a week later, we played them down here at Scott Central. They beat the living dog shit out of us.
Previous season, they had a losing record, and there'd been a coaching change, and was brought in to see if we could change the climate, attitude toward the program a little bit, and maybe build a winning atmosphere. And from the atmosphere comes success, and from success begets tradition.
We had no plays under the previous, you know, the coach before him. You just go out there and basically just do what you what you want to do. Street ball, pretty much.
The first 3 years I played, you know, we ran a lot of 30-second drills that everybody runs. Coach come in and told us that, you know, if we run in practice, it's going to be with a ball in your hand. And he taught us how to work together as a team the whole time we went through practices. Changed our philosophy that way. You know, it was a team-oriented game, even though we had players that could pretty much dominate the game on their own if they wanted to.
Early on, we tried to explain to them that the perception of other people is that Charleston basketball players cannot run offensive patterns and they don't play defense. And if we're gonna ever get any respect from other teams and from the area media and the people out there, so they'll wanna come and see you play, we're gonna have to show people that we can do those two things.
But when Mitch came, oh man, we had so many plays. It was ridiculous. I know at least 70.
Yeah, we had a lot of plays, but they all had kind of designs off each play for everybody. If somebody wasn't shooting or couldn't get hot or couldn't get open, you ran through the play until somebody had the open shot. I mean, it was all about getting somebody a free shot, an open shot.
So they worked very hard on learning some plays that they could run on offense, multiple offenses as a fact, and they bought into playing team defense, and we played multiple defenses, which were keyed off of colored towels. If we played man-to-man, held up a red towel. If we played a 2-2-1 press and dropped back into a 2-1-2 zone, we held up a blue towel. 1-3-1 was a yellow towel. You know, you're getting big gems and big games, like in the semifinals or the finals of the Cape tournament or the finals of the Sykeston tournament, or as we went up the ladder through the state tournament series, crowd noise would be so loud they couldn't hear you, and all it took was a look to the bench and see the color of towel that was being held up, and they knew what defense that they were supposed to be in.
I mean, we never expected to go to state and win state. That was, you know, our goal was to get win district and play after that, but
they'd never been to the state tournament before in what we would classify, I guess, as the modern era. They'd won some conference championships, and we were highly competitive and got on a roll and won several games, had a long winning streak there, and everybody loves a winner. And we had people who, speak frankly, got on the bandwagon, and it became a social thing to do.
After every game, there's a guy yelling at me like, "Hey, Terry, you know, three more games, four more games." And I'm looking at this guy like, I had no idea who this guy was.
Every step, it seemed like you gain another 100 fans and so on and so forth.
But that was the first ever. I had never been in a high school that went to the state tournament even. So this, it just gave you the fever. You wanted more. And so each year then you expected to go to the state tournament.
That particular team laid the foundation for where we are today. See, that club only technically lost one game. And that was in the state finals to Joplin Memorial, and they had a great player by the name of Cat Johnson who played at Tulsa. Really, really talented player. Game went into overtime, and Rick fouled out in overtime, and I think he had 38, maybe 39 points. I've forgotten, I think he set a high school scoring record in that particular game. What made that game so difficult for us was the fact of the inequality in the free throw situation. They shot 36, they had 36 tries, and we had six. I think we made 35, maybe 35 out of 70 or 75 field goals, and we still couldn't win the ball game. You know, even missing 40 shots, still had the lead, and if we could have kept them off the free throw line, but we just could not seem to do that, and we had people in foul trouble, and consequently you're playing different people, which alter what you do offensively and defensively, yet we were still in the ball game and forced them into overtime. But that collectively, that group collectively, probably was the most talented of the three clubs that I had while I was here. And some people even say it may have been the best team in the history of the program, even though there's been teams that have had maybe a better record than that. That club was really, really talented, 1 through 8 or 9. And they won an awful lot of ball games on the road against good, good teams. Rolled through the state playoffs until we got to the state championship, and then we just couldn't overcome the foul situation. I think everybody wants to or would like to have an opportunity to coach at the college level, okay? If you've had any degree of success, and that's a goal or an aspiration, that's one consideration. And you know, the other things, I had three children at the time, and finances were a consideration, and the monetary and opportunities of working at the college level and the benefits that went with that were far greater than what you could have at the high school level. And it had to be a choice made. And in talking with my father-in-law and my own dad, my own father at that time, they both said, you know, don't let opportunities pass you by. You might not get another chance to make this move up to the next level.
Well, I think the dream of all, quite a few of young men, is want to be a professional athlete. That's the dream of a lot of people, a lot of kids. And it was my dream also to be a professional athlete. Then later on, after I noticed, known that I was not going to be a professional athlete, then I wanted to do the next, the best thing is to coach kids. And that's how I ended up being a coach. Believe it or not, I was offered a job at East Prairie High School, and this is right out of college. And at the time, Mitch Haskins was the head coach, and he and I got to talking, and that's how I ended up at Charleston because of Mitch Haskins.
Mac had gone to the service after he got out of high school, and he put in some service time. When he came out, he went to Three Rivers and played 2 years there, went to SEMO, finished up his collegiate career there. When he graduated from SEMO, he'd been hired as a head coach at East Prairie. And I convinced him, convinced him that he would be better off coming into our program, that it had a greater chance for success and a chance for him to learn and grow in that program and end up in a better coaching situation than maybe starting out at East Prairie. Anyway, that's the way I remember it. And he was a guy couldn't ask for a better assistant or a better friend during the period of time that we were together here at Charleston. We just spent countless hours together going to games, scouting games, comparing notes, working with kids, trying to improve individual skills so they could be bigger and better contributors in our program. And when the time came for me to move on and for the change to be made in the head coaching realm, it was to keep the same system and the same attitude and concepts of the program, Mac was the logical choice for the job.
I remember that the first board meeting, they didn't give him the job. And I was so upset about it because I felt like he deserved it. And the principal at that time told me not to get so upset about it because he really felt like it was going to work out the way we were hoping it would. And it did.
And it's not so much just black head coach at Charleston. It was the first black head coach from St. Louis to Memphis. In between those, that's what it was. And I didn't know anything about that at that time. Coach Haskins called me and said that, okay, you're going to be the coach here. And I just almost dropped the phone. I was so happy. The community was very, very loving, and they accepted me as one of them like no other place in the world, because again, this being my first job, I didn't know what to expect. But I had families in Charleston who just took their arms around me and just brought me into their homes and their families. Like, I was been with them all my life. And that's because, again, the community was was very supportive.
But I saw in him something different than I had seen in coaches before that. This man was not there just to win ball games. He was there to teach the young men to be young men. And he made sure that they were there for not just to play ball, but to get an education. So I always felt like I could tell him something about basketball players that needed to be fixed, and I could rely on him to fix it. Now, my job was academic, and I intended for them to be academically sufficient to go and do anything on any level once they graduated from Charleston High School.
It was tough, but it was, and at the time, I didn't know how it was going to affect me. But Mitch Haskins, Coach Haskins, is called, he was grooming me for the job. And I didn't know that. He just said, come be my assistant. But I learned so much from him.
Coach Haskins had come to Charleston in 75, and that's first state championship. I was a freshman then the next year I became a sophomore, and I started varsity for Coach Haskins my 10th and 11th grade year. And then my 12th grade year is when Coach Haskins left and went to St. Louis, and that's when I was McFerrin's first year, and I was captain of that team, his very first varsity team.
I inherited Coach Farmer. It was Coach Farmer and I think Michael Dean at that particular time. Those are the two seniors that was coming back off of that basketball team that Ricky Fraser was on. And Coach Farmer, again, he accepted it because, again, you're getting a new coach. Now, you got to remember, my job was easy. It was harder for the guys that was playing for me than it was for me to coach them.
The emphasis was put on something else. So, you know, when you're a kid at that age, you used to doing it one way, and then you see somebody putting emphasis on something else, then it's kind of difficult for you to get into it. Because you thinking, man, what do we need to do this for? Why do we need to do that, you know, as a kid, you know? We did it, and the team caught on to it, and we went to state and finished fourth in state, and we were proud of that.
And that was the key. If Coach Farmer and Mike had not played as hard and had not accepted me the way they did, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you right now. It started right there in that year. I didn't know anything about coaching at that particular time. I just, okay, let's do it. And they really, to tell you the truth, Michael and Danny, they the one that really was the coaches of that basketball team, because I just went along for the ride. Now that was a special year, because again, I had players on that team that anyone could have won a state championship with. And I just didn't want to mess it up. And so that year, I didn't want to make the same mistake I made the first year I went to the state. So we had a little bit better run the second time I went up there. Jewel, again, is the best ball player I ever had as a head coach to coach. And he, again, you see the ball players now in the professional ranks. I guarantee you, from my standpoint, Jewel could have been one of those ball players. He was just that good. He was the biggest guy I ever had to play for me at that time. And being 6'5", 6'6", he could do the things that he could do. And the ability that he had is second to none.
One of the things you're always going to get from Lenny's teams is they're going to play hard. To me, he was a very defensive-minded coach. I guess he really didn't get as much credit as he should have. I thought he was probably one of the best defensive-minded coaches that I've ever run up against. It was always a pleasure. And one of the things that I enjoyed, and I know my kids got enjoyed, is the fact that whenever we played, then we learned something. we got a game that was worth playing, as well as it's very memorable.
Michael Downs is my son-in-law, so he had to do the right thing when he wasn't playing. But and he's probably one of the best point guards I've ever had the pleasure to work with. It's because he was so knowledgeable of the game. And for him to go, and Hardy Crawford was the other Crawford that I had the pleasure of coaching. They were just like brothers. And when we went up there that year, we had some obstacles that we had to get around, because at that time students thought that they could go out and do some things that they shouldn't have been doing. So we had to deal with that. There's a lot of things that other than X's and O's on the basketball court that coaches have to deal with. Especially when I remember going up there during that time, sitting in the on the floor, supervising, chaperone, whatever you needed to do, make sure the player stays in the room. So that was pretty hard at that time for players to understand that coaches are responsible for them. And if they parents entrust them into our care, we take them someplace, they go somewhere and get hurt, and it's a responsibility that nobody really wanted at that particular time. So that was the year that I had more problem with Michael Morris 1983 team than I had with 1980. Cedric was 6'2", 6'2½, and he was a freshman. And I had a player that was about 6'9", and the 6'9" player decided that he didn't want to play anymore, and he was going to be a senior, and he was going to be a senior that year. And so Cedric was the next thing up. Like you hear people say, one go down, next man up. So Cedric came in, and nobody knew anything about Cedric. Again, he's just a freshman. And I turned around and asked Cedric, because Cedric was an all-around ball player. He could shoot the ball outside, he could face the basket, he could play with the back to the basket, he could do it all. But he's still a freshman. And so we didn't win very much starting off with that setup. After a while, I decided to call Cedric over to have a talk. And I said, Cedric, and this is where it is, where this is where the rubber meets the road. You can continue to play like you're playing, you're gonna be a great ball player. And we won't win very much, but you will be very good. And I said, if I change it and put you back to the basket, we gonna win some ball games. The person that said it was, he forgot, he didn't think about no himself. He said, I want to win. Well, case in point, when he put his back to the basket, we ended up winning the state championship that year. That tells you all about Cedric. I remember that year very well. The record was 33-0. That was Lamont and Leonard Corbett team. And that was the hardest year I've ever had as coach, because this is what you do when you're dealing with undefeated teams. you have obstacles that stares you in the face every day. From injuries, people messing with you, you getting in discipline problems, sickness, injury, again, I said injuries, but sickness, just a lot of distraction. And at that time, we were playing the schedule second to none. We wasn't playing any cream puffs. We were playing the Bashans. We were playing national ranked teams that year. So you can't say that the record was tainted because we played big time competition.
I had Marcus bring the ball down that year because I knew Frazier wasn't going to play him full court, man to man. And they had such them two guards that they had with them. You couldn't have had so much trouble trying to get the ball down the floor with my guards because my guards wasn't near as strong as Mac's guards, you know. And so, I mean, it wasn't that they wasn't it. They were just better, you know, had more talent, quicker and everything else, you know.
At that time, it got to a point where I started hoping that we lost because you want to lose before you get to the state championship. The state championship is the ultimate. You don't want to have a 32-1 and didn't win the state championship. So I was hoping to get this bear off our back, so let's get this loss. But it got to a point where you couldn't lose, you didn't want to lose, then that was the stress that came in. That's the stress factor that I wouldn't wish on anybody. The players enjoyed themselves, but the coaches, I guarantee you, we stressed out more that year than we ever have in our whole coaching careers.
Body fix, set screens, whatever it takes to just get the ball in play. Once you get it in play, then you can run your offense.
Carlos McCauley, of course, back for duty for St. Louis. Mario Lucas has a shot by Maryland to get the ball over the top of the defense by the Billikens. 10 seconds left. They can hold for the final shot. Maryland lead by 7. McCauley hit the pull-up.
Springfield, Bass Pro champion of the shootout there in Springfield. Corey, again, that's where he came on the scene because we were playing Christ the King at that time, Lamar Odom, and people like that. They were over there in Springfield. We were playing Christ the King. I don't know the name of the kids that was on that team at that time, but they was all nationally ranked teams as players. And Corey took it upon himself single-handedly to play against those guys out of New York. And St. Raymond, that's who Corey played. We played twice, Christ the King was one. St. Raymond's out of New York is the one that Corey played against. And he almost single-handed beat that championship, won a championship by himself. And what I mean by that, we went into double or triple overtime each time Corey hit the shot to get us into overtime. So he was one heck of a player. And consequently, he went on to have a super career at St. Louis University, because I believe because of that maturity factor that he had from that Bass Pro Championship there in Springfield.
It was a 93-94 school year, and in that year, I had a team that was, you know, I really didn't, I knew it was talented, but I didn't think it was the type of team that was going to make a lot of noise, and definitely think that team would win the state title. I remember playing Charleston the last game of the year. I made it a point to put them on the schedule for the last game of the year, so if I had any chance of measuring what I could do or what my team could do in the state playoffs, it would be playing Charleston at Charleston in that environment. And that's a memorable moment. I don't know if they won it, but they did help us win it in 1994. It's the fact that if you were going to be successful against his teams, it was not something that they were going to just let you have readily. You know, if you beat a Charleston team, you actually beat a Charleston team. They didn't give you the game. You knew that you were in a game every time you played Charleston. Not only at Charleston, when he went to New Madrid, it was the same thing. It's you know, it's the fact that his kids believed in his system. They believed in what he taught them, and they went out and they implemented it and did it very well. I thought that, you know, Charleston, over the years, have had a rich tradition, and it even came richer once he took over the reins. And so I can only remember the fact that what he did, and I think he put Charleston not only on a state map, but on a national map. You know, I think the recognition that he afforded those kids to give them exposure, you know, it's invaluable. You know, you look at the number of games that he might have won or by coaching at Charleston, but I look at the number of kids he put out, you know, the number of kids who have gone on to do bigger and better things. And, you know, as a coach, one of the things that, you know, I know I relish and I know he relished too is the fact that he gave something more than just basketball to the kids, and he did a whole lot for that community.
I had opportunities to leave Charleston a number of times because of the success that the players had at Charleston, and I was a beneficiary of it by luck of being their coach. So I had a chance to go to college and coach. I had chances to do a lot of things, but it came ultimately down to financially, and I had an opportunity to move, to go to another position, no, to go to another job, and didn't have to leave my home. That doesn't come around too often. You have to leave sometimes. So I didn't have to leave my home, and plus get a little bit more money. So that was the reason why I ended up finally deciding to break ties with Charleston. Nothing else. I wasn't upset with anybody. I don't think Charleston was upset with me. It was strictly financial.
We sat down and talked about the personnel that we had coming back. So Mac left, and that was the following year. We were supposed to end up winning 12 games, maybe, and losing 13. I winning 13 games and losing 12. We weren't supposed to beat certain people. And we wanted to prove to the world, at least the kid did, I thought that we were going to win the 12 or we were going to lose the 12. But the kids wanted to play for me for some reason, and they wanted to prove to Coach Mack, and if I'm allowed to say this, that they could play and win without him. And well, we end up that particular year, I think we won 24 and lost 5. I believe that was our record. We got beat in the quarterfinal to go to the state to see who played for the state championship. Well, we got beat the last second shot. That's the main killing point, the last second shot. But it didn't hurt me for some reason. I felt bad, but it didn't hurt me, and it said, well, I'm going to quit. And I think the kid just picked it up right there. We had about 4 seniors on the team, and the rest of them were junior and sophomore and what have you. And they came back the following year, and we went 31-1 and won state.
Basketball, Rashad Oliver scored 28 points and grabbed 12 rebounds as Charleston defeated Mexico 61-54 last night to win the Missouri Class 3A Boys State Championship. And the Blue Jays returned home today where they were greeted by family and friends. The guys went 31-1 this season to claim the 9th state championship in school history.
We kept saying we was number one, but we weren't number one until we proved that we could win the state championship. You know, Mexico won last year. They were still the defending champ, so we knew we had to go out and beat them or whoever it takes to be number one.
A lot of different personality, and you just have to understand each and every one of them in order to work with the kid. And you know, that's what we're here for, is the kids. And if you can be fair and go out and try to do your best and work with them and let them understand that you do care, you'll be all right.
I mean, we went 16-0. And we turn around, lose one game, and then go back and win, 15 in a row. You could say that was a turning point. We were special because of Coach Spencer. You know, what he preached to us. You know, he let us have fun. You know, he let us do us. You know, and, you know, we played on the bus. We did stuff we weren't supposed to do. You know, we did stuff we didn't do my sophomore and freshman year. We wasn't allowed to do it. You know, but that 1996 team, it was special, you know, from top to bottom.
In our third year, we had better athletes, I thought. I mean, true athletes, but no leaders. Everybody wants to be the leader, but we didn't have a leader. And I think we ended up that year 25-4. And I never did keep up with the record. Out of the clear blue sky, somebody came up to me, I don't know who he was, and said, do you know that you've got the second best record in the state of head coaches? And I didn't even dream of trying to find out what was the reason. I was concerned about how did we get beat. But had the best athlete. I mean, we had true athletes that year, but we yet didn't have any leaders. And that was the downfall of me, I guess.
A story. We all have stories. And the story with Coach Spencer, and at the banquet, he wanted to secure his job, I guess, and let everybody know that I don't put too much pressure on me because, again, following Coach Mack and all that. He got up there behind the podium at the athletic banquet. He told everybody at the banquet, now I want y'all to know, Coach Mack didn't leave me anything. I'm sitting there about ready to go. I wanted to knock him out because, again, he had all state players. And hey, he went on and won the state championship with the players that I didn't leave him with anything, you know. So he wanted to do that just to make sure that, hey, I want y'all, if I fail, this is the reason why I failed. But I haven't got that apology yet from Coach Spencer, but I didn't leave him with anything.
He seems on the sideline to many as blowing up. You know, you see him screaming and yelling about calls or bad calls. but everything about him is calculated. Everything is controlled.
I was contacted by Scott Central about a coach coming to coach the girls at Scott Central. And well, quite naturally, if a player has players that play for them, they don't lose contact with them. They think about them all the time. So the first thing that came to my mind was Danny Farmer, and he at the time was in school in Millsap in Jackson, Mississippi. And I think he was in school. Were you in school or were you out of school?
I just got out.
Okay, you just got out of school. And nobody knew anything, so I made the phone call to Jackson, Mississippi. Said, Danny, I need you to come up here and coach at Scott Central. And we talked a little bit about how we were going to do it, how we were going to do this, how we do that. And it was the girls. And I didn't think Danny was going to take the girls, but I didn't know. I just hoped that he was come up here to get his foot in the door. And so the rest is history. He came up here and became a Hall of Famer with the girls over at Scott Central. And then I knew from the reason why I was saying that eventually he was going to be here at Charleston. And so that's the reason why I made the phone call.
How you end up at Charleston, Coach?
Well, it's similar, you know. Coach Mack come over my house. I was at Scott County, had been at Scott County. He come to my house. He said, look, I'm leaving. I'm going to New Madrid County Central. He said, you could be the next coach there. And I said, I don't know if I'm ready or not. He said, nah. He said, you ready, you ready. And then I told him, I said, well, I don't want to go in right behind you, because I knew fans. I've been coaching for 10 years. I knew the expectations. I said, I want to learn your system first. So Coach Spencer. So then when I went over there and interviewed, I told them the same thing, you know, and Coach, so Spencer took over as head coach, you know. I wanted to sit back and learn it before I take it. But that's not the only thing, too. I don't know if Coach Mack remembered or not. I was also at Missouri Rolla, and I was unhappy there. And I made a call to him, and I wanted to go to Three Rivers. And he got me into Three Rivers, too. I got into Three Rivers, you know.
Yeah, I remember that, too. He didn't just make a phone call. He demanded, hey, man, get me out of Rolla. He said, I want to get out of here. That's okay. Let's start working on it.
And I decided to come over because it was an opportunity to get with boys and get, you know, coach boys, because I had two boys. And I wanted and Charleston was, you know, another winner. I knew it was I knew it was difficult. And why I say it was difficult, because they win, you know, a lot expected of you. So I wanted to keep the ball rolling. I knew what it was. 97-98 was my first team. We lost, matter of fact, we lost in the district finals to Coach Mack at New Madrid County Central. You know, it took about 4 or 5 years, you know, we kept getting better and better. People kept trying to listen, and then we went to the quarterfinals. I think I had Lescano and Jordy Mixon, Dante Clark, and we lost in the quarterfinals to the team that won Luther North. They ended up winning the state championship the same year. And then after that is when we went to 5 years in a row after that, you know. Every team is trying to win district, and just like I said earlier, they just as talented as you are. You know, we won this year more than I thought was more talented than we are. They was a lot better shooters than we were, just as more athletic, just it, you know. And you do have to have talent, but I goes back to say, it's the guy that can win it over and get it to do what he wanted to do. It's going to be the difference in it. That's always going to be the difference in the outcome. And we've been very fortunate to get the kids to believe at the right time. We go through our bumps and bruises throughout the season, and then the postseason, we want to be ready.
The funnest game with Danny was when I went back down there and coached. And Danny and them won a whole bunch of games. I don't know how many. And Scott Central had won about... we were about 500, maybe, you know. And Danny kind of took us a little bit lightly. And we got over there, and I had them boys jacked up. I had a guard playing for me that year that was, he would have been a good guard if I'd had him for 3 or 4 years, but he didn't have enough confidence in himself to work hard, you know. And he got over that night and played a flawless game, and we were ahead of him going into the fourth quarter on his home floor. And buddy, you talk about getting excited, he got excited, you know, and I laughed about that all the time. We scared him. Well, they come back and beat us by 3, 4, 5, but I scared him.
It was great. It was a great experience with Coach Cooks. And you know, especially after playing for Coach Mack, playing the Charleston, then to go over there and see a whole totally different system. And that system was successful also, you know. And he was a basketball genius as far as I'm concerned. You know, he could, you know, he just, his system, that fast paced playing and passing it, shooting it, it's just like playing music, just like rhythm when some of those teams, you know, they did it. So it's more like this modern day ball today. It was what I was telling him that last week. I was over there talking to him and I told him, you know, it's more like modern day basketball today, his way was. And it was successful also. So I've had the experience of both, you know, both. And my style is a little bit of both.
My high school basketball career, I think it was pretty special. I mean, like, at the time, I didn't know how special it was going to state all 4 years as a high school player, basketball player. But now that I'm in it and I'm coaching, it's hard. It's hard to get there. And I mean, winning those games, winning games after game after game after game, it's pretty impressive. So with me starting 4 years and playing varsity 4 years, I think, modestly, I think that was pretty impressive, going to state 4 years, taking third as a freshman, and the following 2 years, two runner-ups, and finally bringing home the gold my senior year. So the thing that made the 07 basketball team special was the three previous years, or the four previous years, that our team had went to state to the Final Four and not brought home the first place trophy. Like, with me playing, that being my fourth year of experience on the varsity level, I knew what it took to win. And so the other players, so did most of the other teammates. I think we had some young freshmen on that team, or maybe some sophomores, I don't really remember, but Jaquan Sherrill, Tony Riggins. I knew how to get them on board too. I knew I had to be a leader. Me, Justin Clark, and Sean Sherrill, Jarrell Quinn. We had a nice slew of seniors to get everybody else on board, and we didn't take any sandbagging. If we saw somebody in practice sandbagging, we would call them out on it, or we would exploit their efforts. I think that was a turning point during that season. And I would say that turning point was first game back after Christmas break, played Sykeston Bulldogs, and they beat us on our home court. And that was my first time losing to Sykeston. Rival, arch rival, they beat us on our home court. So we knew from that point that we had lost a little bit of focus. And at that point, that was the wrong time to lose any type of focus. I mean, you got about another month of regular season basketball, then the playoffs are starting. Or another month and a half, and then the playoffs are starting. So right now, instead of peaking or hitting a plateau, we need to be hitting another level, another gear, and becoming a stronger, faster, better defensive, I mean, just all around basketball team. And I feel like when they beat us, they helped us out.
Ryan Barton, real to my right, and Greg Tucker, they are the captains of our team. You know, we come up here to win it all, and I know after last night, there was a little doubt for some people, but I think that game helped us come out tonight and play hard and leave our guts out on the court. That's what we wanted to do tonight, was to leave our guts out on the courts, and I think the kids did that tonight.
How did Thursday help with that? What do you mean by that?
Well, you know, when you don't play very well, you have a good team, it gets to them. And when it gets to them, it motivates them to come out and play better the next time. And we started out the season, you know, we just wanted to, hey, we're going to just play and have fun. And that's why we wanted to end the season. Come off a bad note, let's play, let's have some fun. And I think we had some fun.
Definitely. They didn't really adjust to the game or how the officials were calling the game. So we just really wanted to go to the lane, attack the basketball, and put it in the officials' hands. They called a lot of fouls for it, and that's a lot of made them.
We didn't mind getting in the free throw shooting contest against them either.
That was mission successful.
We graduated. Jerry Carter and Claude Armstrong off that team. They were instrumental in they were very instrumental in third place finish. But we come back, and, you know, we had Greg Tucker, which he was our best player the year before. And we had a good team then, because I had about two of each position. You know, I had two good shooters, Michael Hall, Aaron Cassell. Then I had Greg Tucker. Lee had a good point guard in Ryan Parham. And my post people, Darion Carter and Rashawn Scott, you know. So I knew I had a good team. I knew this was a team that could go up there and possibly win it or whatever, you know. And we went up there and we did that, you know. That kind of come out of, you know, it's kind of weird after you've been up there about five times and then it comes around again and you get to go again. And then, you know, you get up there and then you win it, you know. Because you never think it's going to happen again. It's just that difficult.
Tucker, he's not afraid to launch it. Look at that shot.
How about the length?
Woo.
Stretch the ditch somehow with the drive or the find.
Mitchell, Tucker almost took it away from Snyder, left open.
He does a great job replacing.
Yeah, it did.
It might be a good thing,
maybe
too.
We can overplay the shot. Snyder up ahead to Mitchell. Going to go in for it. Floats and gets it.
First of all, the guys on the team felt like they really had accomplished something. And not so much that first year, I think, as it did in years later as they went to the tournament. I think the guys, they just felt like they could do something and that they were actually stars. You'd see them walking around and meeting little kids, and even though those kids thought they were rock stars or something like that. So I have to say I love this team that went to the state in 2018.
You know, beat the number one team, beat the team in the quarterfinals with the super player that should have beat us. And then the Hogan Prep, my mistake was letting them watch Hogan Prep play. Then they looked, Hogan Prep looked like they weren't that good. They were a lot better than what we thought they were, you know. Been a few breaks here. It's just a lot of variables. It's a lot of little things that can happen that can change the game. You know, once you get up to state, the margin of error becomes smaller, a lot smaller. So anybody that won 9, 10, like he and Cookson, I have the utmost respect. We do have a tradition, but the system, your system is what wins for you, in my opinion. You know, we have the Charleston's tradition, but it had to be carried on and on. You know, we've been through a few coaches, you know, and he implemented some things and I do what he does. Mine's just a modern day kind of, you know, and he also mentioned Scott County Central. I was at Scott County Central for 10 years with Cookson. And he's right, you know, our seventh grade did the same, even our girls, we did the same thing the guys did, you know. and come to Charleston, and I just tweaked a few things. You know, the emphasis is still defense. We still play defense. A lot of people don't know that, but we still play defense, you know. And just speeded the game up some, because that fast pace, he and Coach Cookson both came up with the same results, but had two different styles. And I like that, but it both yield the same fruit. Winning, win, win.
It's a lot easier to sit on the sideline, you know, in the stands, and talk about the coach should do this, the coach should do that. It's so hard where Charleston has, for some reason, and I'm sure that Charleston's not the only one, Scott Central also, Vashon is another one. I think as you go up there a few times and people start to expect this, and they expect you to win a state championship, not taking into consideration other schools and other teams are expecting the same thing. The game itself is so much different than what people have had the pleasure to watch years ago. The three-point line came into effect. That's changed the game. It's changed the game, not for players. They changed the game for fans, because now fans think that all you gotta do is hit a three-pointer. They don't realize that three-pointers are not easy to make, but just go up there and make it, and that's it, you know, the dunk. Oh, just go ahead on the dunk. And got people now, got players trying to shoot three-pointers and dunk and can't shoot a free throw.
Right.
Those are the things, the reason why it's changed so much. And because of what the fans expect, we as coaches have to take a seat back to let them do the coaching. I remember when I was here at Charleston, put this in perspective now, we won a state championship last year, the year before. The very next year, I was a coach of the year, that year we won the state championship. The very next year, Charleston, same folks, the ones thought I was so great as a coach. The very next year, I was the worst coach in the world. Now you go figure that out. How did I become such a great coach this year, and the very next year I was the worst coach in the world? Well, that's because what Charleston and every other fan base want. They want, what have you done for me lately? What have you done now? Not last year, not year before, not year coming up, but what are you doing right now? They forget about how hard it is. These other schools are very talented as well. Let me stop you on that Hall of Fame stuff. That's a statement. I hear people say, use the word, but you don't become a Hall of Fame coach without Hall of Fame players. See, and that's where I get off that bandwagon real fast, for the simple reason, I and Coach Farmer, we both, and Coach Spencer, and Coach Haskin, we all have had tremendous talent. And these guys sometimes go beyond their expectation in doing the things that they do. Great players make great coaches. And that's the reason why I said, let me talk about that Hall of Fame. Because every time you talk about Hall of Fame, it's not what I have done. It's not what other coaches have done. It's what the players bought into and what they achieved. I don't know if Danny feels the same way, but that's just the way my feelings is.
Yeah, you got to have talent. You know, I've said that many, many times. Well, you got to have talent, you know. But I like to take it a little deeper, too. But, you know, we were talking about great players, and Coach was talking earlier that it's difficult to coach a lot of talent. Well, see, that's the difference in the coach that has success and the one that doesn't. He can somehow get his talent to work together to achieve something, you know. See, there's lots of people that don't go to state that have more talent.
Well, Brian, to me, was another coach. I had the pleasure of having Coach Spencer and Coach Fitzgerald and another coach, Coach Shoemate, But I also had Brian Gillespie, and he was just an added person that was a coach on the floor as well as off the floor. But he did more off the floor because his blood definitely was blue. I'm telling you that now. It wasn't no red blood. His blood was blue. And case in point is when I left Charleston and went to New Madrid and came back to Charleston, Brian, he hated my guts. You know, I'm telling you, I'm thinking about me and my family, and Brian thinking about basketball. He didn't care who I was. My blood wasn't blue at that time, and he wanted to make sure I knew that. So he was definitely a coach that everybody wished they had on their program.
And I agree with Coach McPherson. You know, I came over and Brian kind of at the end, and he's right. Brian, and I see him the same way. He was more like a coach. You know, he knew the system. He knew everything. He knew that Charleston system. He knew it well. And he was good with the kids. And just like he said, he bleed blue. No doubt about it, he bleed blue. I remember Coach first time, Coach come over and played us. And Brian, he up the dressing room. He wouldn't let nobody come in the dressing room.
Yeah. And I'm talking.
I never seen anything like that.
And I'm telling you, you have to be there to believe that, to see it. Because again, you would think that being all of us just like family, that family was broke. You know, it was broken. I even asked Brian to come go with me when I left Charleston. He said, no, I'm blue. I'm all Charleston, you know. So again, you wish that you come up and have a part with somebody's life like that, and Brian was one of them.
Yeah, you may lose a game, he may be crying.
Yes.
He was a dedicated guy.
He ready to fight. Ready to fight anybody about Charleston, New
Jersey. My best Brian story, though, I really enjoyed. Coach had left, and we were playing Peoria Manual. You know, no guy who at the Superman Classic or Marshall County Shootout or whatever, they couldn't find anybody to play Peoria. Peoria was ranked number one in the nation. And old coach, well, I play anybody. Coach Chris, I play anybody. I said, man, you want to play them? I play anybody. Well, we played them. We went over there playing. And we had a quick point guard, Rico Coleman. They had a guy about 6'6". He couldn't even drive around it. And they end up, you know, we had about a 40-point lead or whatever. And I looked at Brian and I said, man, this is great. Yeah. Brian looked around me, Coach, what you play there for? And I had a good time. Brian, he was upset. He was mad. He looked around me and told Coach Chris, Coach.
Oh, boy.
He was,
That's Brian. That's Brian. Because he hates to lose.
Yeah, he hates to lose. He's mad then. He's mad over that, but he's mad. Yeah.
With me taking over the PE coach after Coach Former and possibly becoming the next head basketball coach of Charleston, it's definitely pressure. Definitely pressure. Because, I mean, I'm out in the community. Fans expect to win every game by 15 points, 15 to 20 points. Whenever they don't win, they don't like anybody. They don't like the coach, they don't like the players. So, I mean, it's always going to be pressure. I mean, you got Coach McFerrin as a Hall of Fame coach. Coach Former is a Hall of Fame coach. Those are big shoes to step in. I mean, with the expectations being so high and with the accolades that those guys acquired, yes, it's definitely pressure.
It feels good to be able to do that, you know, to know that I'm gonna turn it over to him. And he was, like you said, three-time All-State, played on one of my state championship teams, you know, and another guy, because it feels like it's somebody that you helped to be successful. Same as here talking to you today. Somebody that you had something to do with in being successful, make them believe it, because that's what it's all about. I love the basketball part of it, but for a kid to catch on to the things that I'm trying to say, you know, the more people you have successful, because it's about life. It's about life. That's what it's all about.
I graduated from Charleston in 2000. My sophomore year was Coach Farmer's first year
being head coach, which was 98. And I played varsity my junior and senior year. And Coach Farmer, you know, all I ever wanted to do was be a basketball coach. And Coach Farmer made that happen for me. But over the years, I taught and coached with him from 2006 to 2010, and we spent every day together. Like, we practiced together, conditioning, did the laundry. Our planning periods was the same period, so we would talk during school. And so he became so much more than a coach, but so much more than a mentor as well. If it had not been for him, I would not be sitting here right now as a six-time author, as a public speaker who travels the country, who get paid thousands of dollars to speak, as a filmmaker or a director or as a scholar, or, you know, so I wouldn't be an award-winning educator. All of these things, he spoke into me. So to that, and for that reason, I always love him. I always love him for that. So I hope this film really shed light and insight on the impact of the first state championship basketball team in Charleston, because from that first state championship, it bred a Coach Mack, it bred Coach Spencer, it bred a Coach Danny Farmer, Hall of Fame Coach Danny Farmer, Hall of Fame Coach Mack. It bred so many others, Corey Frazier, Lamont Frazier, myself, Jamarcus Williams. So many people came out of this coaching carousel that it not only impacted the people inside of Charleston, but St. Louis, the people across the country that I touched, the people across the country that Coach Corey Frazier touched in coaching USA basketball. See, so this legacy, their legacy, extends well past the city limits, well past the high school, but nation and worldwide.